Yeah, let's send it off right. Let's try to get a 4-1 or a 5-0. This is a pretty good speculative hand. Like, I have the ability to generate massive amount of mana if I can just find one action card, and that can come in the form of Elvish Visionary, Green Sun Zenith, Glimpse of Nature, Natural Order. Even Craterhoof Behemoth or Allosaurus Shepherd might get the job done. Do people in Legacy ever play with Engineered Plague in the sideboard? They used to. Now it's Plague Engineer, which is just usually a better version of that effect. But yes, Plague Engineer is one of the scariest cards for the Elf deck. All right, that's a pretty decent start. Right on time. Although this can probably find me an action card, so it's really not that bad. Yeah, I say let's do it. Visionary, that's pretty much just what we wanted. Thespian Stage. So big questions here are, can I find a third turn kill? And if I don't, will I get a fourth turn? Yeah, that's good. So now I have to get real lucky to find a third turn kill. Have to draw. Well, Natural Order for sure does it. On the board, I have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 mana. So Green Sun Zenith or Craterhoof, we're getting close. Allosaurus Shepherd, okay. That is going to force a chump block with the Dark Confidant. Dinosaurs. See, this card is just, it's just such a great card all around. You know, you tend to think of it for being the matchups where they have Force of Will or Chalice of the Void, but here it's just like, you know, I had some extra mana, you know, hanging around and turned my 1/1s into 5/5s. Boom. Can be a tough matchup to sideboard for the Turbo Depths deck. I think basically the two Assassin's Trophies are slam dunks. And then there's a number of other cards that I could turn to if I wanted to, namely Thoughtseize. I kind of like to just focus on winning fast because Thoughtseize sometimes, like, Thoughtseize often slows me down more than it slows them down. It's going to buy me less than a turn on average. More inclined to do like this I don't know, maybe one Thoughtseize, who knows. Agro Crag in the chat asks, speaking of Allosaurus Shepherd, on a scale of I don't need it to 10, you have to play it, how good is the Shepherd? It's really quite good. I would say that if you play zero Shepherds in your Elf deck, you're really leaving some value on the table. It is an expensive card, so like, you know, if you can't get four, maybe you only get two. Like, that's good, you know, that's probably fine. I'm choosing to play four, and I've been pretty happy with that, but you know, maybe you get similar value out of having three or two copies, but it is definitely a really strong card. When do I sideboard in Progenitus? I sideboard in Progenitus against fair decks that can't remove it. The reason I'm not bringing it in this matchup is I can put Progenitus onto the battlefield, they can put Merit Lage onto the battlefield and just kill me quickly. But against something like, you know, Delver, maybe, or Eldrazi, Progenitus can be a lot stronger. Oh, wow, turn two, Plague Engineer. Dancy, thanks for subscribing. Appreciate all you do around here. All right. Think I'm going to play some Symbiotes because they're insects and not elves. And incoming second Plague Engineer naming insect. That is slightly more beatable. Not much more beatable. right. Well, that makes it easy then. So what happens if I Zenith for Nettle Sentinel? And then I can go... I can keep, like, tapping the three elves, bounce the Visionary to untap Heritage Druid, repeat the process. I'll get two more draw steps and then a Once Upon a Time. Alternatively, I could Once Upon a Time first. Pretty interesting, like, where in the process do I want to put the Once Upon a Time? Okay. I still... This is like blocking the Crater Hoof. So I still have a high bar to clear to actually deal 17 damage. Basically, I need these creatures to be 9/9s. So I need to get 8 bodies on the battlefield and then natural order. So what's happening next? I guess I'm casting Once Upon a Time. And I probably need to hit, like, a Visionary or a Symbiote to have a chance. Four, five, six, seven. I think I might have just barely gotten there. So block here, take 8 plus 9, 17. That was sweet. That's one of the toughest matchups too. I was fortunate to escape that one with a 2-0 win. Usually the Turbo Depths deck is like a half turn faster and more disruptive. I was able to have the Assassin's Trophy for the Plague Engineer, which was huge, and then just a great draw in game number one. No glimpse either. Sort of a half combo off with no glimpse. Fetch land was crucial there. That's, you know, I get a lot of questions like, hey, why aren't you playing Cavern of Souls? Why aren't you playing Pendlehaven? You know, insert whatever, like, you know, sweet value land there. My answer is usually just the fetch lands are really important. Being able to go for Forest, Bayou, or importantly, Dryad Arbor is just, like, tremendous amount of value. How do I feel about Storm and Legacy? I think it's really good. It might be the deck that I lose to the most with Elves. All right, this hand is like potentially slow, but I'm going to keep on the strength of Glimpse of Nature. Best card in the deck. Eternal Chaos says, I was expecting the opponent to reclaim up a wasteland to hit your cradle. Don't forget the land from Elvish Reclaimer enters battlefield tapped. I think my opponent played it right, just, you know, forcing me to have the win on that turn. And, you know, I was not a favorite to win. I had to get pretty lucky. So I think my opponent made good choices. What would I do if I wanted to improve my chances against Storm? I think you basically need to sideboard Mindbreak Trap to improve your chances against Storm, because there's a lot of options, but here's the problem is you're going to have to win the sideboarded game where you're on the draw, and a lot of times they just kill you on turn two on the play, which means, you know, Thorn of Amethyst, Collector Oof, any equivalent like permanent-based disruption, sometimes just not good enough. So I think you have to play Mindbreak Trap if you want to improve your chances against Storm, and the problem there is that Mindbreak Trap is very narrow. It doesn't come in a lot of matchups. Dark Apprentice, thank you for the sub, and in regard to your question, I just love the Legacy format. I pretty much enjoy playing any deck in Legacy. Alright, meanwhile, tuning back into the game, the major question here is if I want to like play it slow and try to search up a Dryad Arbor. Maybe. Yeah, again, with the tutor targets against Storm, that's, like, fine and good, but the problematic games are the ones where they're literally killing you before you can cast Green Sun Zenith. So, you know, it might give you a better chance in the games where you're already doing fine, but it's not going to correct the problem. I find Collector Oof to be a helpful one of against Storm. I definitely bring that in off the sideboard. You could play white for Gaddock Teague. That's sometimes a nice one against Storm. All right, so it looks like this is kind of my moment to make something happen. Why didn't I use Quarian Ranger for more mana that turn? Because I was valuing having my lands on the battlefield. Oh. All right, what's the move here? Okay. So that's probably for next turn. In the meantime, I'll Zenith for another Symbiote. So what is this going to be? Hard cast Force of Negation. Nuts. So unfortunately, I don't have any ways to untap creatures. So I can natural order, get a Crater Hoof. It'll be a 9/9 Crater Hoof and a 5/5 Heritage. I could kill the Oko. I should probably just go for it next turn. Great question from Basic. Do we think their last card is a backup Oko? that is one of the things that would make sense. They haven't done a lot of like sculpting of their hand, but you know, it seems like they don't have a ponder, a brainstorm, or a removal spell, or a creature, or anything like that. So it is good to think about what could that last card be. Well, thanks R5X both for the sub and the kind words. Yeah, it was backup Oko. That's really sharp from Basic in the chat to notice that. Or to predict that. All right, that was a bit of a slog, but Elvish Visionary eventually fights through Oko. Now, when they have Dead of Winter, I'm gonna use the wishful thinking that maybe they don't have a lot of Plague Engineers and I'm going to not bring in my removal spells. I'll have Thoughtseize and Progenitus as workarounds for possible Plague Engineer. Thinking something like this. Yeah, so I would not bring in Progenitus against the white version of the snow decks because they can have Terminus or Supreme Verdict. But with any combination of Dead of Winter, Toxic Deluge, and Plague Engineer, it's like pretty tough to actually kill the Progenitus once it hits the battlefield. Hey Reid, any particular reason to have no Veil of Summer in the sideboard? Good question. It is definitely possible that I should have one or two Veil of Summers in my sideboard. Here's a couple of things. Number one, the sideboard of the Elves deck is usually devoted to like answering specific problems like faster combo decks or, you know, removing a Plague Engineer or a Chalice of the Void from the battlefield. Number two, this is not a deck where you pass with open mana that much. Like, imagine just against some unknown black deck, I have Forest, Veil of Summer, and, you know, Green Sun Zenith. Like, am I really going to just not cast anything in my deck of all one mana creatures on the first turn? But, you know, it would be a pretty useful card, especially against something like Storm Combo. So I think it would be fine to play one or two in the sideboard. Hello, Canister. Thank you for raiding, and welcome to everybody who's coming from Canister's channel. Playing some Legacy Elves today. That's a ponder and a shuffle. Interesting. So no knowledge at the top of their library. Is this the right time to thought seize, or should I set up my mana so I could do a quick natural order? I mean, certainly thought seize before they hit the 3-mana mark is ideal, but they could counter the thought seize. They could hide their card with brainstorm. Maybe they have a 1-lander and I could take away their other ponder. So a lot to think about here. I guess my inclination is to Thought Seize now, and then next turn I can go like Quirion, Dryad Arbor, and then have two relevant spells back up for later. Can I turn two natural order with Thought Seize back up? I cannot. Alright, they actually Force of Will Thought Seize, which is like the best case scenario. Turn my Thought Seize into a Hymn to Turok. But I think it's probably what I suggested a moment ago. They kept a 1-lander, bricked on the first ponder, and now they have to Thought Seize to protect, or they have to Force of Will to protect their second ponder or their Astrolabe. All right, what now? So let's say I go Quirion Ranger, Gaia's Cradle, Green Sun for Arbor. Next turn, I'm going to untap with access to 4, 5, 6, 7-ish mana. I guess the question is if I want to like just maximize for natural order, or if I want to maximize for these Green Sun Zeniths being threats in the long run. MTG Master says, I like playing elves in Legacy, but I only own 2 cradles. What do you suggest instead of the other 2? Well, my stupid answer is just forest. But if you really wanted to do something other than that, you could play additional copies of Once Upon a Time. You could play more fetch lands. You could play Pendlehaven or Cavern of Souls. You could play one less land. No, I don't necessarily agree with people who say that, like, you should scrap the deck without having 4 cradles. I think you can play a really good version of Elves with 2 cradles. Don't sweat that. But I think you should just probably replace them with forests or fetch lands. Okay, the only thing I would not do is don't play with a land that doesn't produce green mana. Like, you know, Caracas, Nykthos, Wasteland. I would not play with those in Elves. You want your land to tap for green mana on turn 1. 3, 4, 5, 6 mana. So how's this? Zenith for 1, and I'm going to actually do the technique that we've talked about a lot on stream but never done, which is find the Allosaurus Shepherd to make my next threat uncounterable. All right, so Craterhoof would be +4/+4, which means I could attack for 19. It is bad against a single Fatal Push, but kind of looks like my opponent doesn't have that. So even though Progenitus was kind of the original plan, it looks like I might be able to win with Craterhoof, and I'm just going to take that opportunity. Untap the Dryad Arbor, and we're off to the races. Okay, we're still on the what do you replace Gaia's Cradle with conversation in the chat. Don't get hung up on everything needing a direct replacement. Like, you can just win with Forest. You don't need Gaia's Cradle. You don't need to go for Crop Rotation. You don't need to go for Growing Rites of Itlamok. You don't need to go for Nykthos. Like, just play a Forest. That's fine. Not trying to discourage you, of course, if you want to try out, like, fun and interesting cards. I'm just saying don't get hung up on, like, everything needs the closest, you know, functional replacement. Because that's not the case. Alright, let's think about this. I have a zero lander with Once Upon a Time, but this hand is not even that good. Okay, well, let's say I Once Upon a Time for Forest, Green Sun for Arbor, then turn to Visionary. If I brick on another land, this is just a bad hand, so I think I'm going to mulligan. This one is slow, but fine. I'll just bottom the Craterhoof and take it slow. Fun question from Skip in the chat. Did you ever have a tournament where you felt like you got carried only by your great deck choice? So the first thing that comes to mind is Pro Tour Eldritch Moon, which that was the set where Emrakul the Promised End came out. And I made top 8 of that Pro Tour, and I played Red-Green Ramp with Emrakul, which was, like, definitely not the best deck with Emrakul. Like, there were several better, you know, color combinations, options for ways that you could play with Emrakul. But it just felt like, since I had gotten far enough as playing a big mana deck with Emrakul, I was, like, so far ahead of so much, you know, such a big portion of the field that it, like, didn't matter that my deck was not constructed that well. It was just basically, like, having Emrakul in your deck gave you such a high win rate that, like, the rest of the details hardly mattered. Okay, so tuning back in, looks like I'm up against a traditional dredge deck, which is you know, a reasonable matchup, but this is not a great matchup for me to have a very slow hand like I have here. What exactly do I want to do? I could just play a Visionary, or is there something I can Zenith for that kind of makes this more explosive? Probably I just want to play a Visionary this turn. Maybe go like Bayou Visionary. Wicked Fridge says, why are you taking Bayou over Forest? Don't you expose yourself to random wasteland? Just once the opponent starts with Mana Confluence, Putrid Imp, I'm willing to say that my opponent doesn't have wasteland in their deck. For better or for worse. Could I explain my turn one play? Why fetch for Arbor instead of playing a one drop? So, generally, you want to look for opportunities to get that Arbor onto the battlefield with Elves, because you have Quarian Ranger and Wirewood Symbiote, which can untap it. You have Gaia's Cradle. You have Craterhoof Behemoth. Like, the Dryad Arbor just has a tremendous amount of value. And since the particular one drops I had in my opening hand didn't really, like, they didn't really give me more mana, they didn't progress my game plan very well, I decided that I would just get the Arbor while I can, save the other creatures in case I draw a Glimpse. And I thought it was a good opportunity to get Dryad Arbor. Now, if you replace the Wirewood Symbiote with Llanowar Elves, then I'm going to play the Llanowar Elves on turn one. But in this particular case, I just went for the Arbor. But great question. Thank you for asking. All right. Let's see if I can just have a miraculous draw off this Elvish Visionary and actually make something happen here. So I think I'm blocking the two Icarids. That should be putting me to one. Not saying it's a great spot to be in, but one is better than zero. Have we not seen Creeping Chill from this player? There is Firestorm in my opponent's deck. Good to know about for future games. Inclined to do something like this. Maybe I want to trim on the visionary symbiote stuff. Wonder. Natural Order is probably one of their go-to names with Cabal Therapy. I'll go with my instincts here. So be it. If I was playing against a, if I was forced to keep a hand like this against a deck with removal spells, like say Delver, sometimes what I do is I play the Cradle first. And then that guarantees that you can go like Dryad Arbor, tap the Cradle, get mana right away. Because it's so bad if I play the Arbor and they Lightning Bolt it, then I have kind of this non-functional hand. But against a deck that I'm not expecting to have spot removal spells, I'm going to gamble on the turn one Arbor. Alright, so I think the move is Symbiote, Cradle, Visionary, Untap Arbor, play a one mana elf. So here's an example. We had that great question in the chat yesterday, last game of why do I go for the turn one Arbor? Like, look how powerful this is as compared to just having a forest on the battlefield. Extra mana from Cradle. A target to untap with Symbiote. Like, it's really a big deal to get those Dryad Arbors out there. Is Leyline over Surgical a metagame call or your default sideboard tech? So the number one reason why I have Leyline over Surgical is when the Reanimator deck has their best draws, they can hit you with Chancellor of the Annex, which means that like Surgical Extraction sometimes doesn't even stop their crazy best draws. But Leyline is like, that's not even a spell that you're casting. There's really nothing people can do. Just going to be the old mulligan to four and then get a turn two kill through a ley line. All right. I mean, I guess I should think about the only thing that I can think about here, which is, do I want to bounce the Heritage Druid at the end of the turn in case I draw Glimpse of Nature? Yeah, I think so. Well, I mean, I'm not sure what else I really could have done here. I was going to have like a turn three kill with a ley line on the play. And if that's not good enough, then I'm not sure what is. But it sure was not good enough in this game. Do I ever play Reclamation Sage or Scavenging Ooze in the main deck? Sometimes Reclamation Sage. I usually don't play Scavenging Ooze in the main deck, no. It looks like their objective is just to put a lot of power and toughness, or specifically a lot of toughness, onto the battlefield to make it harder for me to win with Craterhoof. Just for the daggers, it looks like they have a grand total of three ways to deal with a ley line. All right, all four therapies are in exile, so I can feel safe doing the block and bounce. Not that I think my life total is going to be relevant to the outcome of this game, but might as well save two damage if I'm going to do it anyway. All right, can I get a glimpse? Visionary. Nope. Oh, no mistake. I think without doubt, my opponent was an excellent player. They really navigated through some tough situations with precision. Here they are. I like this hand. Gentleman Finn says, I think Reanimator and Dredge need to mull for an answer to Leyline game two and game three and hope the rest of the hand is okay. I think it depends on the situation. I think that sometimes you just take your lumps. Like, if you have an excellent hand and you have to cross your fingers that they just don't have the Leyline this time, sometimes that's worth it. Bloodstained Mire, usually going to indicate a combo deck. All right, another graveyard matchup. Another matchup where I'm exceptionally likely to lose game one. Is Jund viable in Legacy? I played a little bit of Jund when Ren and Six was legal, but that's not legal anymore. So I guess I would need convincing on, like, why are you choosing that particular color combination? Kim the Turok also lost a lot of value with the printing of Veil of Summer. All right, I think this is one of those spots where I'm just going to get the turn one Arbor. Ooh. For when drawing 14 cards isn't enough. Hello, Sherlock. Thank you for subscribing. Okay, so it's not just a pure reanimator deck, that it's actually got this combo element. Well, I could bring in as many as 13 sideboard cards. Something like this. Not sure if I want the Assassin's Trophies. Trophy might be kind of loose. That's just a good, honest, hateful hand. What if they have Elesh Norn? Well, yeah, that's part of the reason I was thinking about Assassin's Trophy, but I mean, even if they have Elesh Norn, I'm bringing in all these cards to hopefully stop them from reanimating something. Yeah, you know, it could never be a bad mistake to keep in one Allosaurus Shepherd. It is a one mana elf after all. think we're just going beat down here. Alright, let's see how you do against a ley line and 5/1/1 creatures. Should I make a morph? Nah. I think I like attack and then Zenith for an oof. There's probably like some very specific combinations that I could draw off an Elvish Visionary to allow me to win, but I think just Leyline oof and a clock for next turn is going to be sufficient. Do I think the opponent has outs? Yeah, certainly there's combinations of eight cards that my opponent could have that allow them to win. Like, my opponent mulled to four with Dredge last round and beat my ley line easily, convincingly. So, I think I'm going to win this game, but certainly, like, we're still playing for a reason. All right, so the main card that I had considered is Assassin's Trophy. But I don't think I want it. Sure. What are my thoughts on Archon of Valor's Reach? I think it's pretty good. I think it's really close between playing one Craterhoof and one Archon, or just two Craterhoofs. Both choices are fine. All right. So I think I want to try to Zenith for a Birch Lore to unlock these Thought Seizes. So I'm just going to play Dryad Arbor right now. I do have two arbors for what that's worth, but I'm prioritizing the Zenith to search for something more important. All right, I mean, we just have to hope that my opponent needs to draw the reanimation spell. Well, they're not immediately killing me. That's good news. Not dead. Hey, have I somehow not cast a spell yet? That's perfect. All right. Lysurg in the chat made a great point that if they're just waiting to draw the reanimation spell off the top, then it's maybe no longer a priority to Thought Seize them, and I should just focus on clocking as quickly as I can. Collector Oof does something, but not much. This would be, of course, an ideal spot to get Scavenging Ooze, but I don't have that in my deck. All right. I can have a chance of winning as soon as I draw some creatures. Not even red mana to flashback the Faithless Looting. So attack for 5. You're at 14. Do I want to fetch an Arbor to have one more creature, or do I want to Thoughtseize? I think I want to Thoughtseize. ZRS1 says, on turn 1, wouldn't it have been better to play a Ranger off of Forest so you could guarantee a turn 2 Thoughtseize if you wanted to Green Sun Zenith into Birch Lore? It was guaranteed either way, and I'll explain that real quick. It's, I was going to turn 1 Arbor, then turn 2 Forest, tap 1 Quarian Ranger, tap the other, untap the Dryad Arbor, Zenith for 1, Birch Lore. Now I have Quarian Ranger and Birch Lore Rangers untapped. So I had it equally both ways. All right, that I finally feel confident in winning this game now. This game was wild. Like, they, you know, they had the answer to the ley line. They had almost everything all set up. Never drew the reanimation spell. But that's certainly, you know, one of the categories of games that you play with Reanimator. If they draw Exhume, then I Surgical the Grizzlebrand and they get back Grave Titan. And I do not have lethal, so that is something that could happen. Interesting. I wonder if I should have Surgicaled the Faithless Looting in response to Lotus Petal. In fact, almost certainly I should have, right? Maybe not. For what it's worth, I think I'm a favorite to beat a Grave Titan hitting the battlefield, just because, like, it would take them forever to kill me. I have the glimpse in my hand. You know, it's pretty easy for me to combo off. Hazard asks, why not play stuff like Priest of Titania and Elvish Archdruid? I very much consider this a combo deck, so anything that doesn't contribute to, like, the combo kill on turn 2 or turn 3 usually does not get a slot in my main deck. Basically, like, those cards are just not necessary. They would be great sometimes if you cast them and untap with them. But since they're not totally necessary, they get cut when everything gets like stripped down to the most efficient bare bones type of shell. Okay, so this will be a turn one Dryad Arbor game, potentially. Snow-covered island ponder. Cap and Hammer, thanks for subscribing. All right. Do I put in land or visionary? I think visionary. Is that right? Yeah, I think so. I was hoping it would just be an Emrakul and I would get another turn to try to win, but probably not getting another turn against Omniscience. Yeah. Boy, a lot of games where I don't get to untap for a third turn in this league. Very combo heavy league. To recap, I played against Turbo Depths, Dredge, Tin Fin, Sneak and Show, and then yeah, one fair deck in the snow deck in round two. Does Allosaurus Shepherd slow the deck down? I mean, I guess technically, if your opponent had no interaction, you would be a sliver of a turn faster with Llanowar Elves over Allosaurus Shepherd. But it's a one mana elf, so it can't really be a bad choice to play it. A lot of questions about if four Allosaurus Shepherds feels good. I'm convinced it's a great card. I'm convinced you want somewhere between two and four. I say if you have them, you know, play all four, but it's an expensive card, and if you want to start with two, try it out. Like, I definitely co-sign that decision as well. Grundler says, have you ever played on an anonymous account? Do opponents play differently? Yes, people, you know, for better or for worse, they do treat me differently when they know my account name. I actually had one, like, really, really funny to me incident where somebody that I actually knew in real life, like, flamed me when I beat them on an anonymous account. That made me smile. So it's a ponder and a no shuffle. All right. What to do now. Kind of like just glimpse and make them have the force of will. If they don't have force, then I'm going to draw at least three cards this turn. Well, actually more than that. And if they do have the force, hopefully it sets them back enough that I can just get going with Symbiote Visionary. Yeah, I mean, that was a really interesting turn for a number of reasons. Like, in a perfect world, you get the Shepherd onto the battlefield first so that the glimpse is uncounterable. But then if I'm using a mana and a creature drop before the glimpse, like, is it now even worth them forcing it? You know, all of those thoughts combined with just, like, what can I accomplish next turn? I think one time when I was discussing Legacy Elves, I said, like, the way I organize my thoughts is, number one, what can I accomplish this turn? Number two, what can I accomplish next turn? Number three, what can I accomplish, you know, two turns from now or if the game goes long? And sometimes, like, balancing all those questions at the same time in your head is can be pretty tricky, and you have to go on instinct a little bit. All right, so Shepherd, two mana, untap. So I can go Shepherd Natural Order, but it would be a non-lethal Natural Order. So let's try to set up for next turn. I can maybe even kill next turn through like a Grizzlebrand or a Emrakul. So let's see. Let's say for the sake of argument, I go Shepherd. I make four mana. Then instead of casting Natural Order, I go Symbiote, three mana. Bounce Quarian Ranger, untap an Arbor. Recast Quarian Ranger. Now I have two mana. Tapped Arbor, untapped Arbor. Okay, I get more creatures onto the battlefield that way, but I don't get more attackers. I'm just going to prioritize having my lands on the battlefield. Of course, I could untap the Dryad Arbor again and replay Visionary, but especially given that my next turn is either going to be setting up an uncounterable Natural Order or rebuilding after a Pyroclasm, I'd rather just have the lands on the battlefield. Lysurg says, I think you wanted to go for Craterhoof if it dealt enough damage to kill next turn with a normal attack. Good thought. My counter argument is being able to win through a Grizzlebrand. Like, if they play Grizzlebrand, I can never attack again with my normal creatures. A non-lethal Craterhoof would have been good here just to reduce the number of cards they could draw off the Grizzlebrand. So I'll clarify my previous comment. My thought was if they go show and tell, put Grizzlebrand onto the battlefield, go. Now they have a 7-7 lifelink. I can still beat that by going Allosaurus Shepherd, uncounterable Craterhoof. But, the sneak attack, threatening to actually kill me in one go, that does change the equation. Looks like they either didn't find Emrakul or didn't find Lotus Petal. Now, I just have to fade drawing my one Craterhoof Behemoth as my draw step here. That has happened to me before. I call it the reverse one-outer, but hopefully not this time. Multiple Force of Wills doesn't do it because this is uncounterable itself, and then it makes my future spells uncounterable. So they would have to have, like, Gutshot Force of Will, which is essentially impossible. Well, good to know for game three about double pyroclasm. Alright, any changes for game number three? Anything I want to do against the pyroclasms? I think no. Just try to thought seize, basically. Perfect hand. Who knows if it will be good enough on the draw against a fast deck, but this is as good as I can ask for in my opening hand. Yeah, good point that I, as an alternative to natural order, I could have activated the Allosaurus Shepherd. I don't really like Progenitus in matchups where they can just I can just put Progenitus on the battlefield and they can kill me. Alright, so when they can have Brainstorm to hide their best card, do I maybe just want to start with an Allosaurus Shepherd? I think if they had gone, like, land ponder, then I'm thought seizing here, but when they can hide their card with Brainstorm, it might be comparably as good to thought seize on turn two. For what's worth, I also could get a turn two win. It's not likely, but, you know, uncounterable, and I have the Heritage Druid. Like, if I draw Nettle Sentinel there, maybe I could go for turn two win. As it stands, I think I'm going to Thought Seize. Oh, it's not a green card. It's not a green card. Okay, so they can force it. You do your thing. You force it with that Thoughtseize. Impulse in response. Haven't seen that card in a while. Roger that. So let's see if they are A, killing me, B, casting Pyroclasm, C, threatening lethal for next turn, because I have a great chance of winning on my turn if they just go, like, put Emrakul on the battlefield. Grizzlebrand is probably the most interesting of the options. Now, can they draw into a Pyroclasm and another Lotus Petal? Remember, Force of Will doesn't do much. Gross. Probably just never, I don't know. I think this probably gives me the best chance of winning next turn if I get a next turn. Alright, gonna have to settle for a 3-2 in this league. I think I got like tougher than normal matchups in that league. Elves tends to be better against fair decks, but struggle a bit more against combo, and I played against combo 4 times.